So now it's turn to go deep into the code and see how this SDK core class is structured and how it can be extended. And we'll take a Lambda registry example to see the actual car box representation, for example, and custom transactions representation. And later we will see how all this new logic can be interacted with the final users, so the users of the custom decentralized application. So let's start from the box. What is a box? A box is a container for data, such as an amount of ZEN, or the public key of the owner, or more in general, the information of a specific object, like a car's attributes, as we will see a bit later in the Lambda registry example. But let's start from the simplest box, which contains just ZEN. As Alberto said, it's named regular box, so you can see its implementation on my screen. So the value of a regular box, which is in Bitcoin-like terminology, I should mention, regular box is a pay to public key hash you to XOR. It's very similar to that concept. So the value of a regular box represents the amount of ZEN controlled by the box. And all the data fields of the box are specified in the corresponding box data class. So for example, for regular box, we have a regular box data class where we put the value, so the amount of ZEN, and the public key of the owner, which is wrapped in a specific proposition class. So more in general, the proposition is meant to protect the box of being spent or being to be able to be opened by anybody other than the party that is really able to satisfy that proposition. So in particular for regular boxes, they can be spent only by providing the proof of knowledge of the private key corresponding to the public key specified in that box. And for providing the proof, I mean showing the corresponding cryptographic signature. So the regular box implementation, as you can see, is quite simple. It extends the abstract nonce box class that contains all the common logic, but that's not only. So in this class, as we can see, the only things needed is to define a specific constructor, but for regular box, it's just the execution of the superclass constructor, and to define and to set a unique box type ID value. So to be able to distinguish regular box from other type of boxes, like car box, for example. And the rest is just, we need to define how to serialize this object. So how it will be later, we'll be able to transmit this object across the network. So, but about serialization, it will be a bit later. I should mention that regular box class implements the CoinBox interface. As you can see, it's empty, but a CoinBox interface is a kind of marker which identifies that this particular box contains ZEN, exactly ZEN, so like regular box does. And if a box doesn't contain coins, it must not implement the CoinBox interface. So for example, a car box is not a CoinBox because it's managed another kind of entity. So a car, a Lambo. And if a box implements the CoinBox interface, some additional checks are automatically performed inside the SDK. So like, for example, verifying that in a transaction, the total amount of CoinBox inputs is equal to the amount of CoinBox outputs plus fees. So we are sure, no matter what kind of transaction, a core one or the one defined by such a developer, we are fully sure that the CoinBox balance will always will be verified, and we can trust that the balances will be correct for such coin boxes. So no ZEN will be created when it's not needed. Okay, turning back to the box. So just a box interface, which is the base one. So in general, we can say that every box has a value and the proposition which locks this box. But for sure, it can be extended with any kind of custom data, which we'll see later. The meaning of the term value depends on what entity we want to tokenize, with that specific kind of box. So again, for regular box, we tokenize Zen, but for car box, we always tokenize cars. So the value here, for example, is we always tokenize a single car per box, so it's equal to one. Okay, let's switch to the car box now as we start to discuss it. As Alberto previously mentioned, we have a box representing a car, so this car box. And in the Lambo registry example, car box is inherited from the abstract nonset box, similar to as well as regular box does. And the car data is specified in the corresponding car box data class. And the public key proposition is used to protect it from being spied by wrong people. So the car box can be opened similar to the regular box, so by providing a proof of private key knowledge. Here you can see also that car box is not a coin box because it doesn't contain Zen. A car box data class is extended from abstract nonset box data class, but contains some additional fields like vehicle identification number or year or model and color of the car. It's important to mention now that if the custom box data class contains the additional fields, so some new attributes, they shouldn't be mentioned during special custom fields hash method calculation. The mention of them will provide a uniqueness of a box instance, and we will be sure that two car boxes with a bit different fields will lead to, say, two different boxes and two different box IDs. So now we can go to the next box, car sale order box. It will become a bit more interesting and more complex. So similar to the car box, is inherited from abstract nonset box class and also is not a coin box, as we can see, because car sale order, again, it's not about the Zen coins. And what is the difference? The difference is that car sale order box specifies also a price field representing, so a price field to be paid and have a different type of proposition. It has a specific sale order proposition, and inside this constructor, it also have a price. So what payment is expected to be done to satisfy future purchase, but we will see it later inside the transaction. So sale order proposition. But before, say, describing it, maybe I should describe the sell and buy schema, so the sell and buy phase. In the Lambo registry, we want to give the possibility to the seller to place a car sale transaction for a specific buyer. And moreover, we're gonna give the possibility to the seller to cancel the sale order in case the buy order didn't already happen. So reverse this sale operation. So to be able to do this, sell order proposition class was implemented, and we included into the sell order proposition two public keys. One is the public key of the owner, another key is the public key of the buyer, so an owner and it's actually a seller. So this is needed to restrict the sale cancellation to the owner of the car or to allow only the buyer to finalize the purchase. Obviously, the buy transaction must also ensure that the sell order amount is paid to the seller in case of finalization of the buy transaction. So, and all these verifications are performed in the specific transaction implementation. So let's go to transactions and see now what we have inside our SDK and how the Lambo registry implements its own transactions. At first, what's transactions? Transactions are, say, one of the most important aspects in the sidechain. They have inputs and outputs similarly to transactions in the main chain, but they are represented as unlockers. So inputs are unlockers and outputs and new boxes. To simplify, the transaction spans inputs and then sends them to the output. And the outputs of the one transaction can be used as the inputs of another transaction. So the SDK provides a basic transaction implementation named sidechain core transaction. And sidechain core transaction can be used to send coins inside the sidechain or taking some coins to be eligible as a forger or to withdraw coins from the sidechain by submitting a withdrawal request. So more specifically, sidechain core transaction is able to manage the core box types like regular box, forger box, and withdrawal request box. By the way, so similarly to the regular box, a forger box is a coin box as well, but it provides the eligibility to be selected as a forger accordingly to the Lattice proof of stake consensus, which we implemented inside the SDK. On other hand, the withdrawal request box is a special box that contains the amount of Zen coins to be sent back to the main chain and the destination main chain address, so where to send, who will be the owner inside the main chain. So in general, transaction inputs in the SDK are represented as a list of box and lockers, we can see. But what is this box and lockers? So box and lockers is an interface used to specify the ID of the box to be spent and the specific proof which demonstrates the right to open that box. And new boxes, just a list of newly created boxes of the transaction supported types. So for the sidechain core transaction, it's a regular boxes, can be regular boxes, forger boxes, or withdrawal boxes. Also, there is some other methods. So for example, the method to return fee, so how much fee will be paid by this transaction, a timestamp, so when this transaction was created, and also transaction type ID as well should be a unique value to distinguish different transactions between each other during the serialization or deserialization. So when we send it between nodes, we will know what exactly we received. So all contextless validation rules for transactions should be defined inside the transaction semantic validity. So for example, the sidechain core transaction verifies that fee, for example, is greater than zero, or there is at least one input and one output inside the transaction. Other contextual checks, like, for example, the presence of the boxes specified as inputs, are performed directly by the SDK core implementation. So even some custom transaction, core transaction, inside will try to span the box which doesn't exist. Inside the SDK, we will check this case and will reject such a transaction. Switching back to the Lambo registry example, as we mentioned earlier, we have the possibility to declare new cars, create sell orders, finalize the purchase, or cancel the sell order. And for these cases, we introduce specific custom transactions. And if you think, we can see that all custom transactions in the Lambo registry share some common logic. So they require regular box inputs as a source to pay transaction fees or to pay for the car. And they all require regular box outputs to accept coins change if needed. So if in the inputs we have too much coins. For this reason, we introduced this abstract regular transaction class that is responsible to implement this logic. Its constructor accepts the list of input regular box IDs, the corresponding proofs, and the output regular box data to create a new regular boxes, and also transaction fee and creation time. Moreover, abstract regular transaction already implements the unlockers method and new boxes method. And inside it provides what is needed to manage regular boxes. So in the unlockers, it constructs the proper box unlockers for regular box IDs and corresponding proofs. And in the new boxes, it recreates newly created boxes from the box output box regular box data provided. And it should be mentioned that it's a responsibility of the extending classes to manage custom boxes. So we will see right now. For example, a car declaration transaction. It has been designed to allow the declaration of a brand new car. So in the Lambo registry example, we allow anyone to create a brand new car. But obviously, in a real-world scenario, this process will follow different rules. Car declaration transaction extend abstract regular transaction, so it can reuse all the common logic that was described before. I should mention, as was said before, car declaration transaction has the possibility to declare a new car, and this car is represented as a car box which has the corresponding car box data. So the car declaration transaction constructor takes the same arguments as the abstract regular transaction plus the instance of car box data. And if you will go to new boxes, we will see that new boxes method reuse the implementation of abstract regular transaction new boxes method. So it takes calls the super method and takes the regular boxes, which will be the output, and then append to the list a newly created car box entry that has been declared in the constructor. I should mention that there is no need to extend the unlockers methods, because so for car declaration transaction, we're just pending regular boxes during the car declaration and nothing else. But let's go to another one, sell car transaction, and we'll see even more logic here. So the sell car transaction offers the possibility to create a sell order for a specific car, so to put it on sale. It identifies the car to be sold by providing as input the corresponding car box and spends regular boxes to pay the fee. So moreover, it specifies in outputs the regular boxes for coins change and the sell order box with the sale data like the price and the same car information of the car box spent. Its constructor seems very similar to car declaration transaction, but instead of car box data, it receives a car sell order info instance. So car sell order info instance contains the information related to the car box to be sold, signature providing the proof of owning that box. In our, it's a cryptographic signature for sure, and the desired price for the car, and the buyer's public key, so the potential buyers whom we want to sell this car. For car, sell car transaction, we have unlockers method to be overridden. It again, it's called a superclass instance to get the regular boxes information, so box unlockers, and then append it with a car box to be opened with that corresponding proof in the car sell order info. Similarly to unlockers, the new boxes function we call the base implementation and append it with the car sell order box instance. Because of such a representation of the data and how it's constructed, we are sure that the car sell order box, which we want to say create, will have the same car attributes that was in the car box we just spent. Another example is a buy car transaction. So this transaction offers the possibility to finalize the purchase of a sell order for a specific car or to revert a sell order, so to cancel sell operation. In both cases, it spent a car sell order box and regular boxes for fees. And in output, it specifies a new car box instance associated with the new owner. In case of finalizing a purchase, it will also specify in input the regular boxes needed to pay for the car, and in output, a regular box with the car price and the seller address inside that box. So buy car transaction takes same arguments of abstract regular transaction, but it adds the instance of car by order info. So, and we can see that car by order info contains the information related to the order to be spent and the corresponding proof. And knowing this data, it's possible to understand what a car box should be recreated and how to make a purchase, so how to make a purchase regular box, and so on. As we can see in the unlockers implementation, it's very similar to the implementation inside the sell car transaction. But against car box, we spend a sell order box. And instead, the new boxes method has a bit different implementation. It should take in consideration if we are finalizing a purchase. So in such case, if the car box, car sell order box was finalized by the buyer, we will append to the result, the outputs, the needed regular boxes with the payment for the previous owner. This means that we are sure that if the buyer opens this box, he purchased the car, he will pay directly for the previous owner and will become a new owner of the car. Okay, so it's technically all about the boxes and transactions. So we define this structure. But now it's time to understand how later users will interact with the custom application and how they will be able to perform all this logic. Similarly to Zen node, the interaction between, so with the sidechain node is made via HTTP request API calls. So in the SDK, we already provide the most common APIs to be able to interact with the node. What I mean, so you are able to check your balance, you are able to see the blockchain state, you can see another information about the memory pool, or again about the blocks which you are interested in, or you can perform basic sidechain core transaction operations. But the SDK also provides ways to extend or modify them in a specific application, in a custom decentralized application. So for example, in the car Lambo registry, to be able to send a car declaration transaction or a sell car transaction, we introduced corresponding API endpoints. So for better clarity, API endpoints are grouped, and the application API group class is the base class which implements this concept and is like an extension point for any custom API group. Let's see a real example. In Lambo registry, we implemented a new car API, which extends application API group class to provide the possibility to declare a new car, create, accept, or cancel a sell order. So we defined a base pass for this API equal to car API. And also we registered four new endpoints. So to do the operation which I just described. Inside this getRoad methods where we do the declaration, we have a specific bind post request utility method defined inside the application API group class, which give a possibility to, in a fast and simple way, to create the endpoint processing methods for post requests. So where we just need to specify the final pass. So the API, the call address will be look like this, for example, for create car. And we'll specify the destination method, which will process the call, the request, and the data class. So if we will see on the signatures of the methods, like create car sell order, and we'll look on the arguments list, we can see that they have some similar part. All of them take as a parameter sidechain view instance. That is a thread safe object that includes most of the needed information on the node. So it has an access to get information about balances or state of the blockchain and all other information needed to perform any API call. So specifically to create car, it will also receive an instance of a create car box request that represents the data passed via the API like car attributes fields. We can see vehicle identification number, year, and so on, but also owner's proposition and the desired transaction fee for the car declaration transaction we are going to create. So turning back, looking at the implementation of the create car method, we can see that it verifies that request inputs are valid and tries to collect regular boxes from the wallet to pay and define the output and even to pay. So, and even define the potential outputs change if we need to do this. And then it creates the corresponding car declaration class instance and returns its bytes representation in the end as an instance of a TX response class, which is inherited from success response interface, a special object defined in the core. So in case of successful response, this result will be automatically converted to success HTTP response. And in case of any error, we are going to return a car response error, which information will be automatically converted to a failed request. So it will return an error in the HTTP request. So in such a, I hope, an easy way, the interaction methods and API, custom API can be implemented. So, and after this, users can say, execute that calls and be able to do a customs application logic. Okay, for today, that's all from my side. Thanks for attention and back to you, Luca.
Thank you so much, Alexander. That was really great. I hope all the people have enjoyed your part of the presentation.
I hope so.
I'm sure. I'm going to share again my screen and introduce again Rob.
Thank you, guys. Alberto, Alexander, that was awesome. Thank you for taking us through that. And again, stressing to the people joining us here and watching the recording, this is really just the first part of your journey. And hopefully this was a good introduction. What I want to do quickly is to ask us to all take a step back, and you should think about, you know, the basics of, if you're a developer and you're trying to choose a blockchain ecosystem which to develop, there's some key questions you should ask yourself. And obviously the answer is build on Horizon, right? No, seriously, there are some awesome blockchain communities out there, some great protocols. There are solid choices for application developers, for people that want to launch their own blockchains. It's important for you to really dive in and evaluate things holistically. Look at the tech stack, look at the economics, look at the people, look at the community, and think about which you want to join. What you've seen here, hopefully from the architecture technology perspective to getting into the SDK, I hope you see that we've built something that makes it, let's put quotes around, easy to launch your own blockchain using the SDK. Clearly, this is the early, you know, phase of the technology. You can consider this something maybe like Ethereum in 2016. Right, so it's still early days. The tech itself is extremely powerful. Now what we need to do is make the tools more accessible and just make them, you know, more easier for people to use, in particular for you, the developers. So what you get with this, the big picture is we've built what could be a hybrid public-private blockchain ecosystem. So people can choose to allow completely decentralized public actors to run their blockchains, leveraging the protocol, or they could still run their own blockchains with the protocol, but choose and select who they want to, you know, actually be able to run the software. And this would be a sort of permission system. The technology allows for both. What you're getting now here as well is a proof of stake blockchain protocol, and this interoperable with our proof of work main chain. So this is kind of a hybrid security model as well. So you've got the block forging proof of stake Lattice implementation on the blockchain side that we call a sidechain, and then the main chain stays the same, and all this, it's an asymmetric sidechain protocol where the main chain itself doesn't have to know anything about the logic for the blockchains that you choose to build. So that is powerful, and we need to keep digging there to see why you would want to do it. The protocol allows for full configuration by you, the developers. The structure is called data boxes that Alexander walked us through. They can be modified, can be introduced. Really, it's completely generalizable. We're bootstrapping the system with some basic stuff like a Lambda registry. It's kind of a simple example of how you could walk through the process of modifying the SDK to suit your applications or your blockchain. Ultimately, what we've done as well is we've built a very configurable and comprehensive zero-knowledge library called GingerLib that ultimately will be accessible with the SDK, and you'll be able to implement zero knowledge tools for, you know, application data privacy, or things that you want to do on your blockchain, or things that you want to do on your application that use the Zendu protocol that may not even be blockchains, but that's taking this to a completely different level for the future. The network that we have is huge. We have something like 40,000 full nodes on the network running our software. And ultimately these will participate in a node marketplace. So where we're going, if we do this right, you know, sometime from now, launching your own blockchain with all of the accompanying infrastructure, including nodes, Explorer, wallets, and anything else to give you a successful blockchain ecosystem. We want ultimately to be like the process of deploying a smart contract today on another platform, like a smart contracting platform. Clearly, there's a lot that we have to do from here to there, but that's the vision. To get the economics better, it's really important. And like I said at the beginning, to have developer revenue streams. So developers are the backbone of building this infrastructure, building the applications. And we feel quite strongly that it's important for developers to have direct participation in revenue flows across the network. And that's why the protocol itself, or at least the Lattice implementation, allows for developer participation and transaction fees. So also, as a developer, you need to think again about ecosystem and think about your users. So if you're building a blockchain to support different types of applications, whether they're gaming applications, whether you're trying to do a tokenization platform and so forth, You need to think about things from the perspective of your users, not only how you are going to earn revenue, but what costs your users are going to pay, right? And think about this as if your blockchain or your applications are successful and you start getting high transaction throughput on your chains, you don't want fees to scale faster than usage, right? You don't want them to even scale anywhere close to usage scaling. So what we've done here is we believe that we have delivered an architecture that can actually allow for fees to remain low while usage scales, because you can have different functions that happen on different blockchains that are all interoperable in this blockchain or blockchain's ecosystem. So overall, we think that the architecture is right for scalability. And hey, let's get to the soft and tangible stuff here. We're a very nice team to work with, and that matters. So if you're choosing to build in a protocol or on a protocol in an ecosystem, it also matters who you're working with. We want people to come and build here. So we are going to be extremely accessible. We want to be extremely responsive, and we want to help you. So we're a good group of people. Come work with us. You'll be part of a large and rapidly growing community that, quite frankly, is dying for these types of applications and dying for the infrastructure. We've just launched a platform. Now we need to build an ecosystem around it. So think about the opportunities that are involved in there. Who wants to come and build the first tokenization platform? Who wants to come and build the first stable coin within our ecosystem? Right now, we're at the earliest phases where you can come in, you can build this smart contracting platform, you can build any of the things that our ecosystem absolutely needs. And now the tools are here, and we're providing the environment and, you know, truly the incentives to come in here and participate. Be the first, be the early adopters. There's a lot that we can do together. So the calls to action out of this: join the early adopter program, Heath. Follow us on GitHub, obviously, so you can see the code contributions directly. Participate, log issues, actually push PRs, code fixes as well. Join our Discord, in particular the sidechain channel, so you can participate in the conversation with respect directly to this technology. We have a Horizon Developer Environment, HDE, where we have real work tasks available right now with bounties. So come participate. I mean, really, this is the start of hopefully a much broader journey we do together.